Right, good evening, everybody.
Good evening.
Welcome. Especially any new faces. Nice to see you. Right, a massive welcome back to Neil Sanders with The Dark Arts of Marketing. Neil, author of Your Thoughts Are Not Your Own, Volumes 1 and 2, and highly recommended, by the way, delivers a unique presentation in sales seminar format, taking us through how to sell more effectively, altering other people's beliefs, use of rhetoric and distorted truth, sales techniques used in the news and politics, strangely enough, laid bare tonight. The amount of influence that can be brought to bear on individuals and populations is evidently astounding. Now home to a fine art, priceless information that can provably manipulate others. Please welcome Neil Sanders.
Thank you, and welcome to tonight's seminar. Thank you for coming. Today, I'm going to show you how to draw the most out of your target consumer. We're going to look at some of the tricks of the trade that are used to ensnare potential buyers and alter their perception of our product. By product, of course, I don't mean just commercial goods. Oh, no. We also deal in the highly lucrative business of politics, government, and selling ideologies. Now, I know what some of you are thinking. Oh no, this is a sales seminar. It's going to be full of pie charts, isn't it? Well, I can tell you categorically that no, there will be no pie charts used for the majority of this presentation. So, relax. First things first, when approaching a potential consumer, understand that everyone is a potential consumer at all times. So control of the information and one's image is paramount. That is why I'm wearing this suit. It clearly shows that I am better than all of you. That is the authoritarian picture that I wish to paint. Here are my qualifications. Oh yes, it just got real. Now, none of you know that I actually stole this suit from a Guy Fawkes dummy. And even fewer of you know that that stands for Bronze Swimming Certificate and Silver Swimming Certificate. And I would never tell you that. Of course I wouldn't. It would undermine my power base. It doesn't matter that I am a complete and total fraud. What matters is your perception of me. Now, here is a very simple trick. A very simple example of how I might try and get all of you on my side. Yes? I've taken my tie off. This is a very simple trick. It's employed by politicians when they want to appear human. It disguises their evil intent, and it goes a long way to hiding their contempt for the general public. It's a tactic that we in the industry call engaging with the scum. I could go even further. I could take my jacket off. I could roll my sleeves. I could become one of the workers. But to be quite honest, I'm slightly concerned that those people will come and steal this suit back, so I'm just going to keep it on for the time being. But another tactic that we use now that you've got to remember is we don't point at the proletariat anymore. I mean, sorry, I don't mean proletariat. I mean consumers. We don't point at consumers anymore. It's rude and it's domineering and you come across as a bit of an arse. So we do this. It's far more inclusive, and again, it goes a long way towards hiding the disrespect that you have for your audience. Now, what I could also do is use clever language to try and make it seem that we're all, you know, similar, which we're not. I could say I'm probably very similar to you. I grew up on a huge sprawling estate, a massive estate it was, terrible, and it wasn't uncommon for me to be awoken by the sound of gunshots. I know you think that I'm talking about an estate like this. My estate was more like this, and the only gun crime that I ever encountered was Carstairs putting the wrong bloody shot in my gun. But I can see that I haven't connected with some of you, okay? It's just jealousy. It will pass. It is natural to be envious of such an alpha male. But try not like me after I hit you with this body blow. Yeah? That's me with a dog. That's me with another dog. Well, it's the same dog. That's another one of me with a dog. And that's me with two dogs. What are you going to do? This is a very simple tactic that has been used time and time again by evil people to soften their image. It's also used in films. It doesn't matter how crazy or how mad the character is. We know to like him because the dog likes him. But most of the time, it's just used by terrible, terrible, terrible people. As we can see with this last one, it doesn't always work. Walter Lippmann, my hero. May he burn in peace. He'll be down there now, looking up at us and probably screaming. But he had this to say about how we can effectively control the braying herd. That's you. He, along with Edward Bernays, worked in conjunction with the fabulous Tavistock Institute, who believed that only by causing repeated trauma to civilians, you can bewilder them enough so that you can control them from an exterior point. The opening chapter in Walter Lippmann's book, Public Opinion, is titled The World Outside and the Pictures in Our Heads. And in this, he explained that the pictures in people's minds, the ways that they see things and their assumptions of what is real, is their method to interpret roles and positions in the world. People's understanding of the world through these conceptualized pictures denotes how people conduct themselves in everyday situations. This, then, shall be the clue to our inquiry. We shall assume that what each man does is based not on direct and certain knowledge, but on pictures made by himself or given to him. If his atlas tells him that the world is flat, he will not sail near what he believes to be the edge of the planet for fear of falling off. If his map includes a fountain of eternal youth, a Ponce de Leon will go in quest of it. If someone digs up yellow dirt that looks like gold, he will for a time act exactly as if he had found gold. The way in which the world is imagined determines at any particular moment what men will do. It does not determine what they will achieve, but it determines their efforts, their feelings, and their hopes, not their accomplishments or their results. Remember, the important thing is that products are sold on emotions, not logic. So, how can we, as advertisers, begin to alter those pictures painted inside the minds of our consumers, or more effectively, how can we paint those pictures in the first place? Well, in the advertising industry, cunning turns of phrase are often utilised to fool the consumer into believing something that is not necessarily true about the product. This is carefully crafted, though entirely deceptive, so that no wholly false declaration is made. Advertisers use the manipulation of words to shape perception of brand identity and their attributes of their product. One of the main techniques used is the inclusion of what is termed in the industry as weasel words, and these can include comparative phrases such as like and as much as, qualitative words such as I, virtually, virtual, acts, works, can be, tackles, fights, descriptive words such as healthy, fortified, enriched, natural, or strengthened, which may, on closer inspection, be rather more vague than they actually appear. The term weasel words comes from the hollow nature of the words that are presented. Weasels feed from eggs, sucking the insides out through tiny holes that they have made. When they are finished, the eggs, like the words, appears to have content, but is in fact a hollow shell. The main point is that the advertiser's definition of a word may differ greatly from yours. So, what does this phrase actually mean? Helps control dandruff symptoms with regular use. Well, whoever stayed perfectly silent was correct, because that phrase means absolutely nothing. Let's examine it. The weasels include helps control rather than stop or prevent. Helps control, what does that actually mean? Symptoms. Removing symptoms may not actually include the removal of the actual visible flakes. Remember, the claim is not that the product stops dandruff, only that it can help control it. And even this is qualified by the phrase regular use. Your concept of regular use may be quite different from the manufacturer's. Fighting, tackling, or enriching is not the same as defeating. In politics, you could use the phrase, this is exactly the sort of thing that we should be doing. Should does not mean we will do it. You could say, I shall look into this forthwith. Well, what do you mean by look into it? What do you mean by forthwith? That could be 10 years' time. Or you could always call for an independent inquiry. Now, this isn't lying, okay? So don't feel guilty. This is us doing our job. This is what we're paid to do. This is business. It's dog eat dog. Can't stand the heat? Sod off out of the kitchen. Can stand the heat? Right, well then let's approach the owners and try and upsell them some sort of air conditioning unit, yes? Yes. Now, when searching for a washing up liquid, we often see phrases such as leaves dishes virtually spotless. Now, your brain will latch onto the spotless rather than the virtually. However, the inclusion of the word virtually allows for the company to set their own standards of cleanliness, which again may vary wildly from your own expectations. Many of you may have seen this ledger. No animals were harmed in the making of this movie, which is particularly strange. This appears on the end of the Hobbit film, which killed 27 animals. It appears at the end of The Life of Pi, which permanently traumatized and nearly drowned a live tiger. It appears at the end of The Pirates of the Caribbean, which killed hundreds of types of fish and made a type of squid extinct. It even appears at the end of War Horse, which killed a horse. You see, in this term, harm means intentional. Personal hygiene products are replete with these types of words. Listerine fights bad breath. It fights it, it doesn't stop it. No mention of how effective this fight is. Now, as an aside, did you guys know that the Listerine company actually invented the word or the medical condition halitosis as a selling point? Halitosis is a completely made-up disease, invented by the manufacturers of Listerine and publicised as being the primary source of bad breath. Listerine was marketed as the only available cure for this newfound disease. This is pure genius, and if they weren't a rival, I would applaud their deviousness. So what are all these products? Fruit juice concentrate, glucose, sucrose, fructose, nectar, maltose, malt syrup, corn syrup, dextrose. Well, these are all ways that we can hide sugar content in the healthy products that we're promoting. In the marketing of beauty products and makeup, we can also see examples of these phrases. Helps reduce the visual signs of aging. This is another sneakily manipulative piece of wordplay. The advertisement says reduce, not remove or reverse. Also, visual signs of aging is a fantastically vague term. The product, often, the product does not remove these signs, it merely temporarily helps to reduce them. Now, often makeup is actually poured or presented to look like chocolate or some other type of confectionery. It's scooped, presented in bowls, or smeared like ice cream. Even pet food is marketed to be as appealing as it can be to the savvy consumer. This is to project a positive image of the product into the mind of the consumer, even if the positive qualities are, in essence, not really real. Remember, products are sold on emotions, not logic. Advertisements will often use a technique which is referred to as unfinished claims, which work by making suggested comparisons. The comparisons are never explained, nor evidence, but instead suggest concepts to the reader or listener, and they are supposed to make the inference, and allow for the consumer to fill in the understanding for themselves. One of the most famous of these is 4 out of 5 dentists surveyed would recommend Trident for their patients who chew gum. Now, the questions we should be asking, what this does is make us think that, wow, a lot of authority figures who seem to know what they're talking about recommend this gum. I should probably go and get that gum. This looks like a beneficial product. The questions I would be asking are, who are these dentists? Where did you find these dentists? What do other dentists recommend? The most pressing concern is that one of these 5 dentists thinks this product is so disastrous that he wants absolutely nothing to do with it whatsoever. I want to speak to that dentist. Now, these questions will never be answered because it would nullify the effect of the statement. But this is an example of what Edward Bernays, another one of my heroes, called third-party advocates.
We are hardwired to believe that people in positions of people are in positions of authority based on the logical assumption that they're in that position for a reason. They know what they're doing. Also, it's really good because it subtly removes any responsibility from your mark, from your consumer. Now, here's a question. How many doctors that you see on adverts are actually doctors? Well, nearly none of them. Most of them are actors playing a role. Now, I would trust them to get me a cappuccino in a California restaurant, but I really don't want their medical advice. You see, Edward Bernays clarified that public relations is merely the marketed phrase for peacetime propaganda. You see, the name public relations was required as propaganda had picked up all these negative connotations, thank you very much, communists and Nazis. And so in order to successfully propagandise during peacetime, we had to change the name. We marketed the phrase and came up with public relations. Pretty nifty, huh? Another technique is to imply to the reader or the listener that the product is better by simply extolling its superiority and its uniqueness. So you might see phrases such as the best a man can get or the drive of your life. Now, what do any of these phrases mean? Nothing. The slogan doesn't actually describe the product, but rather projects an implied standard tying in with the constructed image of the brand, yet giving no evidence to its claim. And this is also completely true of political slogans. Yes, we can. Change we can believe in. Ready for change. Change, 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 change. Remember, the main point is keep it vague. Allow people to attach their own meanings. Think about it. If you define something or make promises, you might actually have to live up to them. And this isn't anything that any of us want to have to do. My particular favourite is this one, Bye Bye Bureaucracy, which was created at great expense by a committee. I'll just let that one sink in. Bye Bye Bureaucracy was created by a committee. Remember, emotions, not logic. A water is wet claim says something about the product that is a universal truth. The claim is usually a statement of fact, not a real advantage over the competition, but promoted in such a way that it becomes an attractive feature of the product. For example, Mobil Oil once used the slogan Mobil, the detergent gasoline. Now, the company was fully aware that any and all gasoline acts as a cleaning mechanism for the inside of your engine, but they chose to use this as a promotional tool appealing to the savvy consumer. Esso markets its products as working on a molecular level. Well, doesn't everything? Again, politicians can do this. We can say things like, people need jobs, I want to make education work. We deserve a health service that serves the people. Meaningless, brilliant, pointless. Simple distraction techniques that will make it appear as if you're actually trying to do something, rather than just trying to appear like you're trying to do something. And hopefully, it will slow the procession of angry voters beating a path to your door. If there's a disaster, that is great. Disasters are what we all want. Get yourself down there, take your tie off, roll your sleeves up, get a hard hat on, and get some carefully choreographed photo opportunities. Just you being there will appease these morons, at least for a time being, and then you can go, free to do other things, safe in the knowledge that you did your bit. Remember, as a politician, you're there to manage society and maintain equilibrium. You're not there to change the world. Now, I know you have to give the impression of wanting to change the world, but this is nothing that any of us will ever do. You can sell these on hollow promises, on emotional pleas, not logical ones. Another example of a water is wet claim is Rheingold beer, the natural beer. It promoted the fact that it was made using water, grain, hops, and barley. Now, some of you may have noticed that those are the ingredients of any and all lager drinks. But Rheingold felt that this was unique enough to be their main selling point. Now, this is a very contentious issue. American Spirit and many other natural organic tobacco products advertise themselves as being chemical-free and made with 100% organic tobacco. Now, many of these companies are actually being taken through the court system in America at the minute, because what this means is that nothing is done to the tobacco whilst it is growing, no pesticides or chemicals are added, and then it is taken out of the ground and mixed up with a load of chemicals that make it work as a cigarette. Also, there are chemicals in the paper. So it's not entirely... Well, it is. It's not a lie. But it's not entirely true, is it? Also, I like the Indian. Doesn't that just make you feel like Earth Mother when you're toking away? Nice appeal to nature there. I like it. Now, advertisements will frequently focus solely on the fact that these products contain natural ingredients. Not only will the component elements of the product be shown, but often the setting is outside. But often the setting is outside, frequently in countryside surroundings, highlighting the product's connection to nature. The misnomer is that none of these products arrive at the hands of the consumer in a natural state. Ketchup, for example, is very rarely found in nature. These products are processed, these products are manufactured for consumption and put together. They may well contain all natural ingredients, but they've been put together in what is essentially an unnatural manner. Even something as basic as a cereal bar or a packet of porridge oats may well contain all natural ingredients, but the packaging and presentation is also completely alien to the natural world. Something is only truly natural if it is found in nature, unchanged by man's influence. Now, the misconception here is, in all these adverts, that natural is always better. Natural is somehow healthier. Natural is somehow better for you and more life-affirming. Well, that's not always the case. Scorpions, herpes, malaria, and dog feces are all technically natural. Jam is not. But I know which one I would prefer spread on my breakfast toast. We can also suggest that the product itself has specific beneficial qualities, and this can be seen in phrases such as contains twice as much iron, which stands to reason is twice as good for you, or helps aid natural digestion, which is one of my particular favourites on these probiotic yogurts. You know what aids natural digestion? Eating. Pie and chips aids natural digestion. Jelly and ice cream aids natural digestion. Technically, 4 pounds of heroin put into condoms, swallowed and taken across the border aids natural digestion. So where's my advert? Advertisers will also use what is termed a vague claim. Vague claims use colourful, emotive phrases which are ultimately meaningless, as well as the use of subjective opinions that can never really be truly objectively measured. And this is often used in the promotion of makeup. You could say something like, "Your lips have never looked so luscious, madam." Or you could even say something along the lines of, "Why, your eyes have never been so seductive, sir." Now, these statements can neither be proved nor disproved, and they're highly subjective. The definition of seductive or luscious is also highly personal, but in both those cases, I was telling the truth. Now, advertisers can also use statistics, lies, damned lies and statistics, as we call them, to impress their case. This kind of advertisement evidences its claims by using scientific proof or experiment. Cleaning products are particularly good at this. The advertisement shows the cleaning prowess of the product, often with its very specific numbers or an impressive-sounding mystery ingredient. Think of shampoo adverts. Most contain some sort of patented mystery ingredient with a requisite science fiction type name, like hexatane complex or neutrillium or Pro-V or any of those ridiculous made up. Did you know that the phrase dermatologically tested merely means that the product has been tested on skin? Acid's been dermatologically tested, but I'll tell you now, ladies, it won't give you the results that you're looking for. Colgate toothpaste made the claim that using its product reduces plaque by up to 98%. Aside from the phrase "up to" being a wonderful weasel word, the advert makes no claim as to the measure of their statistics. Is this 98% more effective than brushing with another brand of toothpaste? Is this 98% more effective without toothpaste? Or is this 98% more effective than not brushing at all? we will never know. Now, just to give you an example of how the phrase up to is a fabulous marketing tool, if you look on your chairs, you'll see that there's some envelopes floating around. Now, if you'd just like to open them, you'll find that they contain a cash prize of up to £1,000. A cash prize of up to £1,000. No winners? Oh, shame. Oh, that is unfortunate. Oh, hard luck. Oh, well done. Now, statistics in advertising can actually use what's called spurious rigour. Now, this means using seemingly incredibly accurate measurements in their claims. For example, a product may kill 99.9% of germs or reduce the signs of ageing by 14%. Now, the implication made by the advertisers is that if the percentages are so precise, then it stands to reason that the experiments and the research done by the company must have been very accurate indeed, and above all, scientific. Kellogg's ran a series of advertisements in the early 2000s that claimed that children who ate cornflakes for breakfast were 9% more alert during the day. How they worked this out, we can only imagine. Now, when I worked at Kellogg's, we had a system that employed darts being thrown at children. Whether they still use this or not, I couldn't possibly tell you. The Kellogg's website also claimed that their product made their children 17% less emotionally distressed. Again, we must wonder what measurements were taken to gain such precise results. Darts. Again, politicians can use this. They can fling around large numbers to condemn immigration, or the obese, or smokers, all of whom, by the way, are goldmine markets that need to be exploited. But this is always meaningless. It's a blame game of distraction. The important point is to control the information. Talk about benefits, but don't mention the huge amounts spent on expenses. Of course, nobody will truly do this, as we don't want to mess up the apple cart, do we? Mention immigration, yes, but never discuss the ongoing costs of war. Never, never, ever discuss their legality. Hold up some dictators like the United Arab Emirates or the Saudi Arabia, or tacitly support the occupation of Palestine, but chastise other bad dictators, bad ones like Assad and Hussein and Gaddafi, at least when they have outlived their financial usefulness. Customers can also be flattered into making smart consumer choices. You can buy a product that shows you're being good to yourself. Shampoo and hair products are sold on the understanding you can buy this product because you're worth it. Well, thanks. French social psychologist and sociologist Gustave Le Bon was the author of several works in which he expounded theories of herd behaviour and crowd psychology and how these events can be manipulated in order to impose control of the masses. He suggested that when people come together in crowds, they start to identify with the group at large instead of as an individual. The opinions of the crowd become the opinions of each person, like a mass hypnosis. De-individuation refers to the psychological phenomenon of a person losing their inhibitions because they are no longer identifiable as an individual. The concept of de-individuation has been used to explain why people who are usually placid and conformist can become extremely violent during riots and seemingly give in to the overwhelming mentality of the mob. According to de-individuation theory, the psychological state of de-individuation is aroused when individuals join crowds or large groups and become literally absorbed by it. The state is characterized by diminished awareness of the sense of self and the concept of individuality. This in turn reduces an individual's self-restraint and normal regulation of behavior. Being part of a large, powerful group means that individuals within it feel as if they can get away with actions that would normally be punishable or considered antisocial. They literally have the support of the group behind them. So how can we sort of try and impose this type of de-individuation on consumers? Well, celebrity endorsements are one of the oldest tricks in the advertising book. Even if we know better than to buy something just because a famous person claims to like it, we nonetheless remember the pitch and the product. And if we happen to like that celebrity or agree with their political, dietary, philosophical, or stylistic stance, we might be even more inclined to be swayed into buying the product. Politicians can also do this. Some of them do it quite well. Some of them look like they're being mugged. Some of them do it incredibly well. And some of them have their hearts broken when the guitarist of their favourite group tells them that they're no longer allowed to listen to them anymore. Now, Chris Royack of Brunel University described the public's relationship with celebrities. Royack defined this as a parasocial relationship based on what you believe you know about the person through the influence of the media. This is despite the fact that you've never met the person, and the projected idea of the celebrity could not truly represent the personality of that person. This is not dissimilar to the way that fundamentalist religious types seem to have a relationship to God. Therefore, we process celebrity-endorsed products on an emotional level rather than a rational, logical one, and those emotions are then absorbed in an impulsive, instinctual way. There is a psychological explanation for this, which also explains the public's obsession with gossip. You see, we stare at pictures of celebrities as in our tribe. They're the successful, dominant members, the alpha members, if you like. Psychologically, it is vital for our social success to gather useful societal information on the powerful. Think about this. If we act a little bit like the successful, we can become a little bit like the successful. The more I learn about the methods devised by the alpha male of the group, the more I can learn in order to increase my chance of survival. And this is also seen in the instinctual drives in the animal kingdom, in various species and in various habitats. In experiments, chimpanzees will happily go without food in return for pictures of the dominant male in their group. The chimpanzees will happily trade sustenance in return for the more important social information. Now, the only other types of pictures that they would, you know, exchange and gladly withhold food for were sexy pictures of female monkeys' hindquarters, which I think is something we can all understand. You know, when I say that, right, I've just heard how that sounded. I don't mean, you know what I mean. Now, even the adoration of celebrities is stoked to encourage others to join in with the mob mentality. Famously, Brian Epstein hired groups of girls to scream at the Beatles, therefore hyping up the rest of the crowd and creating sensation. Frank Sinatra's press agent George Evans paid girls $5 a time to scream at Old Blue Eyes and also to faint on demand. Recently, when promoting the fourth Mission Impossible film in India, Tom Cruise was met by an adoring crowd, highlighting his popularity and giving him a photogenic opportunity to further promote the film. It later transpired that the majority of those present were hired extras from a local acting firm, and they were there to give the impression of organic popularity. They didn't know that there was a film out, and they didn't know who Tom Cruise was. Remember, emotions, not logic. You see, people live vicariously through celebrities, and often the idea of the celebrity is a carefully constructed and marketed image, very different to the real person. For example, Rock Hudson, Montgomery Clift, Laurence Olivier, Raymond Burr, Joan Crawford, Katharine Hepburn and Cary Grant were all promoted as heterosexual icons, but in their private lives were homosexual. If rumours are true, so were Peter Falk, James Dean and Elvis Presley. Recently, Trudy Styler, the wife of the singer Sting, has revealed that his legendary reputation as a tantric sex god was nothing more than a joke that the public ran with and believed. Although flattered and delighted that the rumour stuck, Sting had to admit that the story was fabricated at a press conference by none other than Bob Geldof. That's true. Douglas Aitken, the former brand manager for Procter & Gamble, was interviewed for the PBS television programme The Persuaders, and in this he discussed how and why consumers choose particular brands and what elicited their loyalty. He also spoke about the role of a brand manager and how this has changed as advertisers become more skilled in drawing in consumers. When I was a brand manager at Procter & Gamble, my job was basically to make sure the product was good, develop new advertising copy and design the pack. Now a brand manager has an entirely different kind of responsibility. In fact, they have more responsibility. Their job now is to create and maintain a whole meaning system for people through which they get their identity and their understanding of their world, of the world. You see, during a focus meeting, he had a eureka moment. When discussing a pair of trainers, he noted that a lot of the consumers were talking about this product in really evangelical terms, and he felt that the devotion to certain products was cult-like in its manifestation. In order to capitalise on this for future advertising campaigns, he decided that the best course of action was to study the techniques used by cults in recruiting new members. If Atkins could find what pushed a person from mere fan to disciple, perhaps we could market that knowledge. So he interviewed dozens of cult members, religious devotees, and also hardcore fans of what he termed cult brands, those with particularly devoted followings. Having correlated his evidence, he stated, "People, whether they're joining a cult or joining a brand, they do so for exactly the same reasons. They need to belong and they need to make meaning. We need to figure out what the world is all about, and we need the company of others. It's as simple as that." You see, these techniques are now widely used within advertising, and the concept of understanding your place through the world through the image of the products you're associated with, along with the inclusion of a group. And that is the object of emotional branding, to fill the empty places where non-commercial institutions like schools and churches might have once done the job. Brands become more than just a mark of quality. They become an invitation for a longed-for lifestyle, a ready-made identity. And this is true of political parties in the main extent. A political party is nothing more than a brand, a commodity to be quantified in an ideology, an unachievable ideology, and sold along with the prospect of hope to the gullible masses. It could be argued that people buy products just simply to fill the hole in their psyche. By surrounding yourselves with luxuries, you're living the affluent dream, you're keeping up with the Joneses. And just as we learn to decode symbols like men's toilet or no entry, we can decode the symbols and signs and signifiers of luxury brand identity, these symbols of affluent service to patch over the cracks and bolster our ego, and also act as a badge of success or affiliation. Now, these attachments are most effective when the values and ideology of the product is absorbed into the psyche at the youngest possible age. Gene Kilbourne wrote in the book Can't Buy Me Love, How Advertising Changes the Way We Think and Feel, "Not only are children influencing a lot of spending in the present, they're developing brand loyalty and the beginning of addiction to consumption that will serve corporations well in the future." According to Mike Searle, president of Kids R Us, which is an American clothing company, "If you own a child at an early age, you can own this child for years to come. Companies are saying, hey, I want to own this kid younger and younger." Now, the Cola Wars refers to a marketing rivalry between the two principal manufacturers of cola drinks, Coca-Cola and PepsiCo. Now, this competition really took off in the 80s, with both companies spending millions on advertising campaigns to convince the public of their superiority. Both companies relied heavily on celebrity endorsements. Mariah Carey, Kiss, Tina Turner, Britney Spears, David Bowie, Rod Stewart, Giovanni, Elvis Presley, Michael Jackson, Madonna, and Ray Charles all like Pepsi, whereas Whitney Houston, Paula Abdul, Weird Al Yankovic, George Michael, Christina Aguilera, Max Headroom, and Elton John all prefer Coca-Cola, apparently. Now, the companies also claim that their products taste better, and they have legions of fans who would attest to this. I don't know if some of you remember the Pepsi Challenge, but this was a blindfold test which Pepsi ran, which always curiously seemed to favour Pepsi as the preferred brand. Coca-Cola had similar marketing campaigns. But in 2004, Reed Montague of Baylor College of Medicine performed a series of experiments which indicated that the enjoyment of the product was based more on marketing and perceived expectation rather than actual taste. In his experiments, Montague performed dozens of double-blind taste tests on both products to determine which flavor was the more popular, noting beforehand the original preference of the test subject. He discovered that there was no discernible favorite distinguished by those tested. Even subjects who had previously had a preference were, in blind taste tests, evenly split. Most claimed that they could not tell the difference. In the next stage of the experiment, Montague served his subjects with two cups. Both contained a sample of Coca-Cola, although one was blank and one was labeled with Coca-Cola marketing. Montague discovered, despite the fact that the drinks were identical, 85% of test subjects proclaimed that they preferred the taste of the labelled drink. Strangely, when he repeated this with Pepsi, there was no apparent preference, so Montague determined. What this meant was that taste was not as important as the perception and expectation of the product created by marketing. Coca-Cola's advertising has convinced consumers that they prefer drinks which they believe to be Coca-Cola, regardless of the actual taste. There are visual signs and marketing messages that have insinuated themselves onto the nervous systems of human beings that consume drinks. It is possible that these cultural messages perturb taste perception. Montague also observed the test subject's brain activity via an MRI scan whilst they drank either Pepsi or Cola to see what, if anything, was their response. The results showed far more activity in the brain when drinking was preceded or accompanied by Coca-Cola branding, meaning that the subject's brain interpreted that they were enjoying the experience more, regardless of the actual liquid. Coca-Cola's advertising had a measured effect on the neural activity of the test subjects, increasing the perceived pleasure of the experience in the mind of the user. This demonstrates that advertising can actually alter our sensory perception of reality, which is great. But what becomes clear is that the concepts of any brand identity or the social implications that are tied to them are not real. The trappings of a brand are carefully constructed marketing campaigns designed to present a perception of the product to the potential consumer. These associations are part of a constructed, accepted reality and have no basis in fact. So what's the most successful marketing campaign of all time? Well, perhaps De Beers. You see, in order to make diamonds synonymous with glamour, and marketing, glamour and celebrity, and more important, with love engagement, De Beers took marketing to create this. We all know that a diamond ring is the traditional engagement gift given to the woman as a symbol of love. But this is a construction. Diamonds have been positioned in our conscious to fill a certain symbolic role. Diamonds themselves are not actually rare, although mining for them is undoubtedly not an easy task. Diamonds are certainly not rare in an economic sense because supply vastly exceeds demand. In order to maintain the high price of diamonds, De Beers creates and maintains artificial scarcity by stockpiling mined diamonds and selling them in relatively small quantities. Nicky Oppenheimer, the chairman of De Beers, famously said, "Diamonds are intrinsically worthless, except for the deep psychological need that they fill." You see, in the 1930s, the world price of diamonds was quite low, as engagement rings were considered a luxury after the First World War, and on the rare occasions that they were given, they almost never contained diamonds. You see, at this point, there was no real connection in the mind of the public between diamonds and love. So, in 1938, De Beers hired N.W. Ayer and Son, the first advertising agency in the United States, in order to radically alter the image of diamonds in America. The agency suggested a clever campaign to link diamonds to romance in the public's mind. The company began to associate the product with the glamour of Hollywood by arranging for stars to be seen wearing rings, necklaces and brooches in major films. De Beers simultaneously had stories planted in national newspapers highlighting the concept that the diamond ring symbolized romance. Even school children were targeted by the marketing campaign, as it is better to target consumers young. NWA outlined a program that included arranging for lecturers to visit girls in high schools across America. All of these lectures revolved around the diamond engagement ring, and the necessity that this was to show that your fiancé loved you. The agency had also arranged in 1946 a weekly service called Hollywood Personalities, which provided 125 leading newspapers with descriptions of the diamonds worn by movie stars. The idea was to create prestigious role models for poor middle-class wage earners. The advertising agency explained in its 1948 strategy paper, "We spread the word of diamonds worn by stars of screen and stage, by wives and daughters of political leaders, by any woman who can make the grocer's wife and the mechanic's sweetheart go, 'Oh, I wish I had that.' Thank heavens we don't do that. So, oh, no, no, we do. Oh, I look at Scarlett Johansson's gling. Isn't that nice?" After diamonds were socially equated with love, glamour and romance, the next step was to make the symbol of the diamond ring a required step in the process of a traditional proposal. You see, since 1939, an entirely new generation of young people has grown up to marriageable age. He said, to this new generation, a diamond ring is considered a necessity to engagements by virtually everyone. The message was so successful that people who could not afford a diamond engagement ring would defer the purchase rather than forego it. But NWA noticed a bit of a problem. You see, when women were involved in picking these engagement rings, they very sensibly decided to go for the cheaper option. Well, that had to be stopped, almost immediately. So what they did to combat this, they created the concept of the surprise engagement, with men picking a diamond ring on their own before popping the question in a suitably romantic setting. This would encourage the men to spend more and more to impress the women and thus increase his chances of success. Also, the larger the ring highlights the more you love the woman. De Beers helpfully suggested just how much you should spend in order to adequately prove your love. But the guidelines varied by nation. 2 months' salary was the equivalent in the United States, whereas many in Great Britain got off the hook with only 1 month. Japan's expectation was the highest, was set at 3 months' wages. When asked, when De Beers were asked why they set these prices, they simply said, well, this was the highest that we felt we could get away with. In 1948, NWA copywriter Francis Geraghty introduced the slogan, "A diamond is forever." In 2000, Advertising Age magazine named this the best advertising slogan of the 20th century. Again, it's all about perceptions and the perceptions of the audience. Emotions, not logic, or facts. Frost Nixon, for example, you may have seen the film, Peter Morgan's enthralling production of British journalist David Frost using supremely skillful interviewing techniques to elicit an admission of guilt from former disgraced President Richard Nixon concerning the Watergate scandal. Frost's great victory, as presented in the drama, is exposed as being rather hollow when you check the facts. You see, Nixon's apparent confession was nothing more than a carefully crafted attempt to present the president in a sympathetic light. The publicity stunt was planned and scripted by the presidential office. It's not clear whether Sir David Frost, as he is now, was complicit in this staged event or whether Sir David Frost was a dupe like the general public. Who knows? Who can say? But even the famous expose of the Watergate scandal itself by journalist Woodward and Bernstein is tinged with the spectre of perception management. Several researchers, including Alex Constantine, have shown that Bob Woodward was actually had ties to the intelligence agencies. Rather than expose a rooting out corruption, the famous Watergate scandal was allegedly manoeuvred to make the public believe they were getting to the bottom of something, whilst actually creating a smokescreen to hide a sustained campaign of assassinations of left-wing journalists, activists, and even members of the right-wing who were considered potential threats to the Nixon presidency. Does this go on in England, this sort of thing? Well, political journalist Peter O'Byrne stated on the BBC's Newswhite programme that the collusion between media and government stretches down to an incredibly detailed and precise level. You see, in 2003, the UK Sun newspaper launched a campaign against asylum seekers in Britain with a series of sensationalist headlines such as "Halt the Asylum Tide Now" and "The Biggest Crisis Facing the UK Today" or "Our Heritage is Crumbling." You see, the campaign was, on the face of it, very critical of the then Labour government. But the culmination of the Sun's operation was an interview with the then Home Secretary, David Blunkett, who was forced to admit, "Oh, I can't argue with the Sun over asylum." The newspaper had seemingly taken up a cause that was pressing in the minds of the public and forced the reluctant government into action, which was presented not only as a victory for the Sun, but also for the general public, who the paper were championing. Well, journalist Peter O'Byrne later managed to find a copy of what is known as the Downing Street Grid, which is a month-by-month calendar of upcoming and important media and social events pertaining to the government department. To his surprise, O'Byrne discovered that that particular month's calendar, printed several weeks before the Sun's campaign, actually contained the very campaign that appeared in the newspaper, in incredible detail, including the date and content of the future Blunkett interview, and detailing how the government would react to the Sun campaign in public. So this means that the campaign that the Sun presented as a spontaneous and organic attack on asylum seekers and the government procedure was on behalf of the people was in itself part of the government's own public relations policy. This was nothing more than an orchestrated performance which served to trick the public into believing they had an effect on the government and, more importantly, that the government and the media were listening to their opinion. I'm sorry, I couldn't even finish that sentence. So, the celebrity defence. What do you do if you're caught doing something illegal? Well, I mean, up until very recently, you could go and see Max Clifford, but he doesn't appear to be answering his phone at the minute. Now, he was an expert at covering up dozens of illegal and moral scandals over the years, including Alan Clark's, MP Alan Clark's, liaisons with underage girls. I mean, failing that, I suppose you could try MI5 if, like Cyril Smith, Peter Morrison or Jimmy Savile, you're just, like, raping children. Fame's also good for that, you know, if that sort of thing, you can just ask Roman Polanski or Jimmy Page or Bill Wyman or R. Kelly or Elvis Presley or Wilfred Bramble or Woody Allen or Steven Tyler or Ted Nugent or many, many, many others. If not, admit to a lesser crime. You see, Michael Vale from Coronation Street, he wasn't abusing girls. No. He was an alcoholic. Pity him. Nigella Lawson, she's not a cocaine addict. No. She was using cocaine to get over grief. Pity her. So, pictures like this, where she has the crazed wild eyes of a 400 quid a day chalkhead, are obviously just an unfortunate coincidence. Max Clifford has a tiny penis. Pity him. Spread false defeat to gain public sympathy, or false accusation, and then arrange for it to be exposed as such so that the accuser will forever be treated with suspicion. Wise, wise words there from former Thatcher aide Lord McAlpine. There's three things to remember: claim everything, explain nothing, deny everything. Wise, wise words from Senator Prescott Bush. Now, the best example recently of this was the NatWest or the Enron 3. Now, these guys were guilty as hell. Just to explain what they did was they stole money from shareholders, members of the general public. They stole money from shareholders. They're just basically a bunch of thieves. But they were guilty as hell. But their PR firm sold lies through the media, which were never questioned, in order to garner sympathy. The crimes were ignored. But the impact on their families was spoken of over and over again. You see, the tiny bone of contention was that they were English and that they had to be tried in America. This was portrayed as a despicable piece of international bullying rather than the proper procedure that it was. Lies were told that they would be interned in Guantanamo Bay, have to appear in orange jumpsuits and be shackled from head to toe. None of this was true, but it tricked the public and several MPs to make appeals on behalf of what was essentially a bunch of rich, thieving bastards. Always, always hire a PR firm before you even phone the police. If you're the star of Downton Abbey and you just happen to like prostitutes putting things inside you, hire a PR firm. If you're the singer of the Libertines and your security guard throws someone over a balcony and you're seen on CCTV running over his corpse into the night, hire a PR firm. If, like Winona Ryder, on an OxyContin binge, you accidentally steal thousands and thousands of dollars worth of clothes from a high-end department store, phone a PR firm. If you're on holiday and your daughter goes missing, phone a PR firm. There's nothing suspicious about any of that. It's the only sensible thing to do. So why have I been acting like this? Why have I been saying these things? Well, I'll tell you, because this is business, okay? All of my actions have been completely appropriate. If you want to succeed in the world of business, you're going to have to change. You're going to have to alter your perceptions, and you're going to have to allow commerce to become the main driving factor in your life. Milton Friedman said that the only moral imperative for a corporate executive is to make as much money as for the corporate owners as possible. Others, like myself, agree. Management guru Peter Drucker says, if you find an executive who wants to take on social responsibility, fire him fast. William Niskasen, chairman of the Libertarian Cato Institute, says that he would never invest in a company that pioneered in corporate responsibility. Quite right. Of course, state corporation laws actually impose a legal duty on corporate executives to make money for shareholders. If you engage in social responsibility, if you pay your workers more money, if you stop legal pollution, if you lower the price to the customer, well, then you'll likely be sued by the shareholders. How many times has an executive announced the redundancies of huge swathes of the company's workforce, only to justify it with the phrase, well, that's business? Or even worse, this is actually really good for the company, or this is really great for the customer. The company doesn't really exist, not in a tangible sense. The company can never be appeased and it will never reward you directly. It's never going to come to your house and make you a cup of tea. Representatives of that company may show you kindness or respect. However, regardless of their position within the company's strata, they too are merely servants to the furtherment of this invisible and ultimately ethereal idea. What is real are the families of those who are made redundant, the people who will suffer because some CEO, only following orders doing my job, placates the ego of this huge invisible behemoth. Redundancies, displacement of entire communities, and murder have all been justified by the mindset of business. So let's not forget, Nazi concentration camps were actually driven by business. IGM, IG Farben, Siemens, Bayer, and even Hugo Boss benefited tremendously in economic terms from the murders committed by the Third Reich. So I'm often reminded in marketing of this phrase from Aldous Huxley's Brave New World: you believe these things because you have been conditioned to believe them. So, were any animals harmed in the first half of this presentation? No, but several were cynically exploited in order to make me look slightly better. That completes the first half of the seminar. Thank you. Hello, and welcome back. So in the second half, we're going to learn more of the tricks of the trade that salesmen and those of us that work in marketing use every day in order to maximise the revenue we get from the sale of product. Now, I was talking to some of you in the break, and some of you seem to think that sales and marketing is in some way immoral. You poor, naive fools, you. Of course it isn't. I'll give you an example. I buy all my Rolexes in Britain, thus boosting the economy, making the pound strong, and giving you dreary folk some sense of identity that you can be proud of. Salesmen are the dream makers. We provide hope in the form of aspiration for thousands and thousands of miserable souls. Why would you want to be glum little old you when you can be Kim Kardashian, eh? Eh? Yes. You see, we can provide meaning for people by giving people an ideal to strive for and to work towards. This could take their entire lives. They may never achieve this. Are you really the sort of person that wants to stamp on people's dreams? John Lennon was a dreamer. Martin Luther King had a dream. Who's to say these dreams weren't about some sort of expensive and aggressive top-down sales marketing campaign? I suppose the real tragedy about their deaths is we'll never know. See, Ronald Reagan himself was wise enough to realise that by not allowing aggressive advertising to children, this is a detriment to American business. By denying them this goldmine market, the industry was unjustly stifled, and therefore the country and people like me were missing out on pots and pots of lovely, lovely cash. Reagan, in his infinite wisdom, deregulated the industry and removed the safeguards that protected children from advertising. Good on him. Thus welcoming a very profitable era for many of the country's wealthiest citizens, which is bound to trickle down eventually and become evenly distributed. It's bound to. I'll give you an example. Don't believe me? My friend recently hired several new staff, groundsmen and servants for his house, yeah? Providing jobs. Furthermore, these peasants will then drive the economy with purchase of high-strength lager and extra-long cigarettes. It's win-win. So some of you are also asking why I've spent the last 6 months living on a boat just inside international waters. Now, is it because I fear arrest? No, of course not. That's an outrageous slander that's been put about there by people who want to see me fail, my enemies, and the police. I simply like the view in international waters. Now, some have also argued that my recent campaign for a skin cream was somewhat misleading. I believe one judge, the Right Honourable Sir Sam Gumster, KMG, called it a mind-blowingly arrogant and dangerous action that would make the most ruthless sociopath shudder with distaste. I say simply this to that judge: who is he to judge? I would simply argue that my slogan was accurate. My product halted the aging process. And to the families of the deceased, my deepest condolences. You see, some have described me as a monster, an immoral, money-driven shit that would sell his own mother into slavery if there was a profit in it. There isn't, I've looked. But this forgets my work with children's charities in the homeless. For example, my ex-wife, Juanita, sadly now missing, very strongly presumed dead. She was only 17 when I found her on the streets of whatever South America. It was one of those Ivia ones. Anyway, she was only 17. I dragged her, that poor, frightened, mute child, off the streets of that poverty-stricken nation, installed her in my house and gave her the body modification surgery that she so desperately needed. Now she has a body that would rival any of the mid-tier American porn actresses. Now, does that sound like the actions of a monster? Yes. Music is a very powerful tool for manipulating people's actions and is used extensively in marketing and sales scenarios. For example, jingles are purposely created to stick in your mind and are often written to be catchy, intrusive, and annoying. A particular song can be subconsciously associated with a product and remind you of the brand whenever you hear it. David Huron wrote in Music Quarterly in 1989, "The classic jingle is the most common musical technique for aiding memorability and hence product recall. One of the most famous mnemonic jingles originated in the 1950s with Pepsodent toothpaste." Music might play different and complementary roles in advertising, such as attracting attention, implicitly or explicitly carrying the message, creating emotional states, or acting as the mnemonic cue. Liking the original piece of music connected to a product can influence our appreciation of the product. In practical terms, classical conditioning implies that pairing a product with a piece of music that people like should produce an association between the two, and therefore a liking of the product. Good music can contribute to the effectiveness of an advertisement campaign merely by making it more attractive. A good ad engages the attention of an audience with the most straightforward way of achieving this is to fashion appeal which is entertaining. Historically, the use of music in advertising originated in early vaudeville, where music served to candy-coat a spoken narrative sales pitch. Music served to engage listeners' attention and render the advertisement less of an unwanted intrusion. The music played when waiting for a call centre operative to answer the phone is used to alter your perception of time and make you less aware of how long you've been waiting. Supermarkets and shopping centres play faster tunes at the end of the shopping day to physically speed up the shoppers. When a band is used during a military parade or a display, those marching along to its tune have reduced fatigue. Musical styles can also have differing effects. For example, lullabies cause your heart rate to slow to mimic the beat, causing you to relax, whereas sea shanties collectivise the group and increase the tempo of their work. Happy Birthday, or alternatively the Funeral March or Here Comes the Bride, have distinct and recognisable social implications. Drums and horns have been used in battle scenarios to intimidate the opposition and gee up the participants throughout history. Excuse me. The use of Rise of the Valkyries in the war movie Apocalypse Now is an example of this, or the use of opening music by boxers or wrestlers as they enter the ring to psych themselves up and get into the correct frame of mind. James Kolaris, a marketing professor at the University of Cincinnati, believes that the use of music can have an astonishingly effective impact on the variety of customers' behaviour. Changing their perception of time, conditioning them to associate a song with a brand, or limiting their ability to critically analyse a potential purchase due to musical distraction. When shoppers are exposed to music in a store, sales resistance decreases. You see, our brains have only so much space for taking in and processing information. So one way to think of this is like an internet bandwidth capacity. If we can fill some of that bandwidth capacity with music and we can provide enough of a distraction, we can interfere with the normally rational shopping decisions, and we can leave little room left for assessing situations and processing ideas. In Battle for the Mind, William Sargent, one of the first mind control doctors, wrote about the use of rhythmic sounds or beats to influence brain patterns and create a conversion. It is easier to disorganize the normal functions of the brain by attacking it simultaneously with several strong rhythms played at different tempos. The rhythm of certain beats, closest to that of the natural heartbeat, can also reduce brain activity to an alpha state ripe for post-hypnotic suggestion. The application of music can also affect mood, which is particularly apparent when we consider the scores of classic horror films. Jaws and Psycho spring to mind. Their tension-building scores have been absorbed into the cultural lexicon as expressions of impending fear and doom. But why are they so successful at this? Well, scientists have shown that the harsh, discordant sounds and unexpected twists and turns used in horror soundtracks imitate the screams of frightened animals, therefore tapping into deep, instinctual, subconscious fears. In a very, very simple explanation, major chords sound happy, minor chords sound sad, and the tempo of a musical rhythm can actually speed up or slow down your heart rate. An example is that traffic moves faster if drive time DJs play higher tempo songs. Genre of music can also be attached to certain products in order to associate them with broader lifestyles of the specific group. Classical music may imply intellectualism, whereas punk may imply rebellion, or hip-hop may imply an urban lifestyle. Once an appropriate medium is chosen, a second consideration of targeting is to engage or captivate those viewers who constitute the target demographic group. Musical styles have long been identified with various social and demographic groups. Musical style might therefore assist in targeting a specific market. The style may function as a socio-economic identifier, a device for addressing a specific audience. I mean, hey, if this car insurance is rebellious enough for Iggy Pop, well then count me in. Even the environment in which the consumer finds themselves is open to manipulation, designed to cause psychological befuddlement in order to improve the chances of attaining sales. In the construction of shopping centres, the Gruen transfer pertains to the moment when consumers respond to the scripted disorientation caused by the intentional, confusing layout of the building. The technique is named after the Austrian architect Victor Gruen. The central concept is that when the consumer enters a shopping centre, they are immediately confronted with an intentionally confusing floor plan, which disorientates them and lowers their reasoning capacity. Often centres will use spiral designs, figures of eights, or crisscross patterns with remarkably similar decor throughout. This disorientation causes shoppers to, in part, forget the original intentions of their visit. This may be the reason that shoppers finish trips with an armful of products, but not the one item that they actually intended to buy. Spatial awareness of the surroundings plays a key role, as does the surrounding sound and music. The effect of the transfer is marked by a slower walking pace and glazed eyes. That split second when the mall's intentionally confusing layout makes our eyes glaze and our jaws slacken. The moment when we forget what we came for and we become impulse buyers. Now, this is not, as I have discovered to my chagrin, a valid defence against charges of shoplifting. No magistrate that I have ever come across will buy the argument that you wandered out of Harrods with three cases of champagne because you were dazzled by the Christmas lights and confused by the powerful effects of the carolers. Now, according to Alan Penn, the director of the Virtual Reality Centre for the Built Environments at University College London, IKEA's sales strategy is similar to that of out-of-town retail parks and shopping centres that employ the Gruen transfer, namely, to keep the customer inside the building for as long as they physically can. In IKEA's case, you have to follow a set path past what is effectively their catalogue in physical form, with furniture placed in different settings, which is meant to show you how adaptable it is. By the time you get to the warehouse, where you can actually buy the stool or whatever's caught your attention, you're so impressed by how cheap it is that you actually end up buying it. Now, what about the humble supermarket? And personally, I have never frequented one of these establishments, but I am reliably informed that people do. Well, wobbling signs hanging from the ceiling catch your attention as the movement is picked up in our peripheral vision and the message is absorbed subconsciously. Red stickers make us assume that there is a price reduction. Even if there is no actual discount in price, we automatically make that assumption because based on what we have seen before. Consumers read shelves like a book from left to right. Premium brands are placed in the middle at eye level, and the most expensive brands are found to the far right, like Hugo Boss to the far right, never mind. Value lines and low-cost products are buried at the bottom of shelves. Now, the airy decompression area provided by the airlock-style entrances is firstly to relax and to physically slow down the shopper as they enter the building. You'll notice that flowers and fruit and vegetables are often found at the entrance of supermarkets. The bright colours excite your subconscious and they put you in a good mood. And it also creates a healthy atmosphere. Subconsciously, however, another more pressing concern is being absorbed. You see, fruit and vegetables rot and die. What this tells you, subconsciously, as an organic being, is you too will rot and die. So you had better buy some food, pretty sharpish, in order to stop that happening. Water is often sprayed onto the fruits and vegetables, and this not only makes the food appear fresher, but also has the added benefit of adding weight. Offers advertised at the entrance of the shop remain in our subconscious, prompting later purchases. Putting bread and milk at the rear of the shop forces people to walk through more aisles where conceivably they may buy more. Related products are often placed together to encourage impulse buys, like a small display of bacon next to the bread section. The artificial smell of chicken or bread is often pumped through the air conditioning units to make shoppers feel hungry. Larger trolleys also encourage more purchases as people are embarrassed by the silly big empty spaces. And the floor tiles in shopping centres are also purposely very grippy. This is not a health and safety measure. It is to physically slow down the shoppers. Put simply, the more time you spend inside a shop, the more likely you are to buy something. Now, many people come up to me and ask me, are you concerned about the decline of the honeybee? And I always say the very same thing. I always say, get the hell away from me, you filthy hippie. But seriously, no, I'm not. I couldn't care less. In fact, the decline of nature, food, and adequate living conditions just allows for far more lucrative markets of opportunity to open up. Honey and spices are fake anyway. Most honey comes from Chinese sources that use corn syrup and sweeteners. It contains absolutely no pollen and so is not strictly honey anyway. Similarly, the manufacture of soy sauce is very time-consuming and very expensive, so most is actually just hydrolyzed vegetable proteins. You know that wasabi that you've just paid extra for? It's not wasabi. There's barely any wasabi out of Japan. It's just horseradish with food, green food colouring. Or maybe it's really, really old horseradish. Crab sticks contain absolutely no crab meat whatsoever. White bread usually uses a lot of sugar. The sugar gives it that brown, homely appearance. It makes it appear darker and therefore healthier. Saffron is so expensive that even top quality is only 10%. It's like buying cocaine in real. The rest is odds and sods and saffron-flavoured gelatin. Chicken is usually pumped full of chicken stock, brine, and mysterious flavour enhancers. This is due to faster breeding. To meet high demand, the meat of chicken is inferior. Because of this, enhancers are required to make chicken meat actually taste of chicken. Would it be strange if they actually used frog's leg flavour? This is all perfectly standard industry practice. It's known as plumping. Even heavily plumped chickens with 40% of their overall weight being enhancers can be sold as 100% natural. Orange juice is usually over a year old, even if it says freshly squeezed on the label. It was freshly squeezed when it was squeezed, then it was stored in vacuum sealed tanks for over a year and comes out completely tasteless. Flavour packs are added to orange juice in order to make orange juice taste of oranges. Flour and oil is often replaced in food with the compound cellulose. Cellulose is ground up newspapers. It is used for binding food and adding bulk, but it is totally indigestible. It is basically wood pulp. Beaver's anal gland juice. No, not the poorly titled adult film of which I was producer and star. But the mystery ingredient that makes the vanilla and raspberry flavour in many, many, many processed foods and beverages. It is labelled as a natural flavouring, which I suppose it is, in the same way that bull semen is a lavish salad garnish. Steaks are often comprised of many smaller off-cut scraps, if you will, the sort of thing that you would feed to a dog or throw at a homeless person. Instead, they're stuck together with transglutaminase, or meat glue, to you and I. This does not have to be labelled. Coca-Cola marketed vitamin water as being able to boost your immune system. They also said it fought free radicals and even hinted in the advertising that it could help fight cancer, none of which was true. Actually, it contains incredible amounts of sugar. During the court cases, Coca-Cola's genuine response was, "Surely no consumer could reasonably be misled into thinking that vitamin water is a healthy product." Salmon is dyed pink. Yup. So the next time you see that idiot marvelling at the hue and saying something like, "Oh, it's so fresh," punch him in the nose and politely point out his mistake. You see, due to breeding techniques and the artificial diet this includes, most salmon comes out greyer than Gandalf's man garden. Hoffman LaRouche dye it pink, and they even have this thing called a salmo fan, which means that companies can choose exactly which hue that they wish to present. Classy. Brand identity, the importance of colour. Colour is an important consideration in your brand identity system. Colours have significant impact on people's emotional states. They've been shown to impact people's ability to concentrate and to learn. They have a wide variety of specific mental associations. In fact, the effects of colours can be physiological, psychological, and sociological. For instance, non-primary colours are more calming than primary colours. Blue is the most calming of the primary colours, followed closely by light red. Test takers score higher and weightlifters live more in blue rooms. Blue increases reading retention. Yellow evokes cheerfulness. This is why you paint your house yellow and have daffodils. Those types of houses sell faster. Reds and oranges encourage diners to eat quickly and leave. Red also makes food seem more appealing and influences people to eat more. And it's no coincidence these are the colours that fast food restaurants seem to use. Pink enhances appetites and has been shown to calm prison inmates. Black and blue suppress appetite. Children prefer primary colours. Notice that children's toys and books are often these colours, and I think that goes a long way towards explaining Jimmy Savile's dress code. Forest green and burgundy appeals to the wealthiest 3% of Americans and actually raises the perceived price of a product, whereas orange can make things seem less expensive. Red clothing conveys power. Colour also has a functional impact on readability, eye strain, ability to attract attention, and ability to be seen at night. The most visible colour is yellow. The most legible of all colour combinations are black on yellow and green on white, followed by red on white. So it's no surprise that most traffic signs use these colour combinations. Black on white is the easiest to read on paper and on computer screens. Hard colours are more visible and tend to make objects look larger and closer, whereas soft colours are less visible and tend to make objects look smaller and further away. Colour can also have physical effects on people based on our learned expectations of the cues received. In a study entitled The Effect of the Colour of Drugs, Systematic Review of Perceived Effects of Drugs and of Their Effectiveness, subjects were given sleeping tablets composed of identical ingredients, the only difference being that some were coloured orange and some were coloured blue. Now, those who took the orange pill fell asleep on average 30 minutes faster and slept for 30 minutes longer than those who had taken the identical orange tablet. As part of the same study, the subjects were given either a blue or a pink tablet and told that they were either sedatives or stimulants, although it was not made clear which was which. As it transpired, all of the tablets were placebos that contained nothing more than sugar. But when the results were collated, 66% of the subjects who were given the blue tablets reported feeling less alert, sluggish, and drowsy, as if feeling the effects of a sedative. And this was due to the association between blue and sleep that is held in the mind of the public. In marketing campaigns, sleeping tablets are most often coloured blue in order to capitalise on this association. The study concluded, the studies on perceived action of coloured drugs showed that red, yellow and orange are associated with a stimulant effect, whereas blue and green are related to a tranquilising effect. Studies have also shown that colours can affect our expectations of strength in medicine. Seemingly, the public perceive warm colours like reds and browns as more potent, especially if the shades are darker. In politics, the visual signs of power can be a useful tool for conveying who is in charge of the situation in a non-verbal manner. There are many signs you can show that you can use to show that you are the dominant personality. Being the last one through a door shows that you are taking ownership of a situation. Placing your hand or arms around another person makes you seem fatherly, like you're mentoring them. Putting your hand on someone's back and giving them a little shove shows that you are literally guiding them in the right direction, taking charge of the situation. If there are three politicians, try and be in the middle as you look like the most statesman. You look the most statesman-like. Try and gain the upper hand during the initial handshake. Now, this does not mean wrestling them to the ground and delivering a swift 1-2 to the groin. No, don't do that. It doesn't go across well. All it means is simply try and get your hand on top. Get your hand in the most prominent position for the news cameras, preferably be on the left of the screen, so that when you shake hands, yours will be on top. You literally have the upper hand. Now, this harks back to the old westerns, where the hero would always enter screen left so that the audience could see his gun. However, this cinematic technique has struck a chord with the subconscious, and now we expect the hero to arrive from the left of the screen. The upper hand in handshakes can actually be countered by an opposing hand grabbing the elbow, giving them the more prominent body part. Another tactic is to pull the opponent in closely to disguise the handshake altogether. If you want to look competent, look stoic. Hold eye contact and smile with as genuine a smile as you can come up with. Just try and think of all that lovely, lovely money. Tilt your head back. Take charge. People with bowed heads seem submissive. The more you tilt your head back, the more dominant you appear. Just don't overdo it. Personally, I've never bought anything from a limbo dancer. Spread out if you want to appear important. Splay your arms and legs. Powerful people take up a lot of space and make bold gestures and generally fill the room. Nod at all times. Nods are contagious and spread good feelings. If you nod, others will begin to nod along with you and start to feel positive about all the terrible things you're saying. When performing a political speech, the words are not always important. Good rhetoric and catchy sound bites are used, but it is more the performance than what is actually said. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to attempt to show you this whilst describing the technique. Start by pointing and waving, even if there's nobody there that you know. This implies that you actually know people in the audience and that you're the sort of person that takes time to say hello to them. It shows that you know people on a grassroots level. It also shows that people have taken time to come and see you. And you're the type of person that never forgets their friends, even if they don't actually exist. Thank all of those who have come a long way. Point to someone, oh, hi, Zoe, and break etiquette, just like that. Show genuine emotion. Clutch at your bosom, as if there was actually a human heart beating inside that hollow shell of a chest. Open with a joke. Not a strong joke, but that will not matter. The loyal will laugh anyway. But I would avoid the one about the blind prostitute in the fishmongers, as this will only upset the prostitutes backstage. To begin with, talk in a homely fashion. Smiling and nodding. As if you're talking to a neighbour. Talking to a neighbour across the fence. Not close friend, mind. Just a polite acquaintance. You could lean forward like this. You could use nostalgia. Do you remember nostalgia? It's great, wasn't it? That helps you connect with the audience. You could say you've come on a long way since humble beginnings. You could say, heck, we've all come a long way since humble beginnings. This shows a further connection to the audience. People are going to say, hey, he's one of us. He's just like us. He's the salt of the earth. But always be calm. Be serious. Be purposeful. And pretend to be sincere. Slogans are to stop you thinking. Slogans are to stop you thinking. All together, slogans are to stop you thinking. Constantly interrupt with slogans and chants and applause. You see, these are called thought-stopping exercises. Whilst you're saying the slogan, you have no time to appraise the nonsense that I just said. The tone of your voice is also very important. Low voices have more credibility. This is how Barry White was able to bed so many women. High-pitched voices seem shrill and can sound patronising. At some point in your speech, you're going to have to start talking in a manner that in some ways mimics the style of Martin Luther King. Speaking on the beat, like a preacher, like a preacher. My voice tells you what to feel. My voice tells you what to feel. The words are unimportant, they don't matter. So long as I'm making strong gestures with my hands and talking on the beat of the speech. Because the audience are stood, they are essentially in a stress position. Getting them to clap, waving their arms, also causes confusion. Music, lights, and sound can befuddle the bandwidth of the audience's brain in the same way that music is used in a supermarket. Mindless repetition, I said mindless repetition, of meaningless slogans again and again and again can entrance the audience, slowly lulling them into de-individuated groupthink. This is the same tactic that is used in evangelical churches in order to instill a sense of loyalty in the congregation. And so you continue to talk as if you're coming to some sort of grand declaration or as if your words actually have meaning. They don't. They don't. But that is not important. Just keep building. Building and building. Slowly raising the volume and the projection. Yes! The projection. Sometimes shouting makes it seem as if you are actually quite passionate about things. But only. Only if afterwards you bow your head and talk much slower. And much softer. Repeating the last sentence. I said repeating the last sentence. Then you build more and more, repeating the same things over and over again like a sort of oratorical teasing machine. Now is the time for good rhetoric. Now is the time for catchy soundbites. Now is the time to blame a minority group for all the faults and problems of the audience. But keep pushing on, harder, harder, raising in volume, raising to an expected crescendo, and then pausing for no discernible reason. Then, finally, talk in a bombastic fashion, much faster than you did before, hoping that nobody notices that you just look quite a lot like Hitler when you did that. Then, bash home those final few pointless words. It really doesn't matter what they are. Hopefully, by this time, everyone's along for the ride. Then stand back and prepare for office. Thank you. Stanley Resser of JW Adger Agency trained advertisers that psychology and human motivation are fundamental to successful advertising. Resser believed that humans are a writhing mass that comes together in a jostling push for food and safety, and that the main thing that people respond to is fear. Now, adverts also use fear to sell products. Fear of being obsolete, fear of being alone, fear of standing out from the crowd and being in the minority. In April 1973, CBS News showed a documentary piece, You and the Commercial, and the commentary of Dr. Eric Fromm particularly raised the hackles of the advertising industry in noting the use of fear as an important selling tool. Dr. Fromm explained, "This is very apparent in all the deodorant ads, fear of body odor and all that, but in a more subtle way, the general fear of not being loved, and then to be able, by some product, to be loved. That's a subtle fear pervading most people, and the ads speculate on that and show, in more or less drastic ways, that here are the things that will make you loved. All that is sought to play on these unconscious fears." Dr. Fromm also noted the healing effect offered by the attainment of certain products. The second thing which struck me was the concept of the miracle drug. Some type of miracle will happen with the consumption of this product. And also the general theme is that love is dependent on a gadget. And this is a very potent theme in our whole modern life. The expectation is that not human power, not human effort, not being, but gadgets create the good life. And there is no limit to what a gadget can do. Henry W. Gadsden bemoaned the fact that Big Pharma could only sell medicine to the ill. Ludicrous. In Fortune magazine in 1976, he said that in the future, drug companies would be more like chewing gum makers Wrigley and would be able to sell their products to anyone, whether they needed it or not. To do this, they would scare people into believing that they are chronically ill and had to buy drugs in order to survive or at the very least live in comfort. Glaxo led the way. You see, at the time, Zantac was Glaxo's new product, but unfortunately, it was prescription only. The problem was that there were lots of other heartburn medicines already available that did exactly the same job without a prescription. Glaxo had a problem. They needed people to actively go to the doctors and ask for a product, rather than being prescribed something by an expert. I mean, what do they know? They had to make consumers see doctors merely as drug peddlers and not diagnostic practitioners. So, Vince Parry of Saatchi & Saatchi changed the way that drugs are marketed. He invented the term GERD, gastroesophageal reflux disease, which is merely a flashy name for heartburn, which it is not certain is a disease. Glaxo played on people's fears of being substandard, being different to the norm. Is your GERD stopping you from enjoying things? Are people looking at you differently because of the GERD? Have you heard the word? GERD is the word, and everybody's heard of... Sorry, I get carried away. When people hear that there is a name for their condition and that the doctor can cure it, then it gives the consumer hope. Therefore, syndromes are invented, symptoms renamed, exploited, all in the name of selling you stuff that does not fix a condition that didn't need fixing in the first place. Did you know that the phrase antibacterial is simply a marketing ploy? Plain soap is just as effective at killing germs and bacteria as any antibacterial product. It's not about science, it's not about rationality, it's about emotions. It plays on our need for protection, our need for purification, and our hatred of nasty, filthy muck. So here's the perfect example. It's a bit glib and silly, but this is the perfect example of a fear introducing advertisement. Introduce a problem that you did not know exists and then offer a solution. Did you know there's a compound within oxygen that could cause your children to die? Well, there is, it's carbon dioxide. But in the advert, you would have two women stood in a nice middle-class kitchen, talking to one another and staring at their perfect children. It's a real tragedy about Sandra's toddlers, isn't it, one would say. Yes, all those innards bursting out like that, the other one might say. Sandra is just a bad mother, the first woman would reply, and then both of them would smile, nod, and look up into the top corner of the room like nobody does in real life. Boom! There you go. A vague fear, a tangible fear, the threat of death to your children, and the possibility that your neighbours might bitch about you behind your back. People would crush their heels to buy this product. Doesn't matter what it is, you really don't have to sell them a product, you have to sell them an idea and a lifestyle. If they didn't buy this product, well, they'd be a bad parent, wouldn't they? So, what do you do if you get caught with your hands in the till, using money for drugs, dead prostitute found in the water tank, or some other such trifling matter? Well, there are methods of making a public apology that can actually prove quite beneficial to your career. Play the I'm a victim too card. Recently, David Letterman apologised on his television show for cheating on his wife. But he started this apology by saying this had only come to public knowledge because he was being blackmailed. I'm sorry for doing all those drugs and running over that photographer. I've been under so much stress recently. That's a good one. Cite a dead relative or an undiagnosed medical problem. Bipolarity is often used by unscrupulous people as an excuse for acting like a complete arsehole, so you could always give that one a try. Being hounded by the press is a brilliant excuse. Claim you want your privacy and do it in as public a forum as possible. Try and do a whole series of interviews in which you stress that you just want your personal space. Apologise in the same medium that you made the mistake. For example, if you tweet something terrible, apologise on Twitter, or at least claim that your Twitter was hacked. That's always totally believable. Similarly, if you are desperate to raise your profile, release a sex tape or some intimate photographs, and then claim that you are heartbroken. Preferably claim you're heartbroken in Maxim or some other magazine in which you can get your tits out. If you're caught on audio tape, apologise on radio, but choose your show carefully. Now, the reports are that Mel Gibson was going to apologise to the Jewish community on the popular right-wing radio talk show Johnny Trueblood's Ubermensch Racial Purity Hour. Though I would add that those rumours are completely and wholly unsubstantiated. In your apology, you wish to appear sincere, so avoid the words if, but, and strangely of all, avoid saying sorry at all costs. Saying if makes you sound sincere. I'm sorry if you caught me in bed with your daughter. Makes it sound like you wouldn't be sorry otherwise. But is the same thing. It qualifies the apology, implying that you feel that you had a legitimate reason for your actions. We know this is true, but we're trying to placate these morons. So please, just stay with me. Finally, do not say the word sorry. Say I apologise or I deeply regret my actions. Sorry has too broad of a meaning and is too commonly used in a social setting. Saying I apologise sounds more impressive and serious. Syllables impress the general public like dangling keys impress an infant. Go on a late night talk show and become the brunt of a few jokes. This will soften your character. Laughter lulls the brain into a false sense of security. If you're particularly skillful, you can literally charm your way out of any situation. All of this has to be considered in context. It is rather dependent on the scale of your infraction. There is no way that Fred West could win the hearts of the public by allowing Jonathan Ross to take the piss out of his curly hair. So, what's a non-denial denial? Well, this is a statement that seems direct, clear-cut and unambiguous at first, but when carefully examined is revealed not to be a denial at all. Therefore, this is not technically an untrue statement. This is an on-record statement usually made by a politician repudiating a journalist's story, but in such a way as to leave open the possibility that it is actually true. And the phrase is credited to the Washington Post editor Benjamin C. Bradley in order to characterise the White House's evasive answers to questioning. So what are some examples of this being used? Well, Bill Clinton, I did not have sexual relations is a non-denial denial, and also a use of the weasel word. The phrase sexual relations did not include any acts that would include sexual contact in the mind of the president. Therefore, he wasn't lying. Tony Blair said, Labour has no plans to introduce tuition fees. No plans does not mean that it will definitely not happen. It just means that it's not been announced yet. Just to clarify, the phrase, I have no plans or I have no intentions, does not mean that it will never happen. David Beckham, on his proven affair with Rebecca Lewes, said in his press conference, I too have been reading these ludicrous stories. Ludicrous does not mean untrue. Michael Heseltine could not conceive of a situation where he would challenge for the leadership of the Conservative Party. When he did, it was due to a series of inconceivable events taking place. Saying no comment, or I'm not going to dignify that with an answer, is not a denial either. But what if you're pressed into a situation where you're expected to apologise and you really don't want to? After all, in some cases, apologising can be seen as taking responsibility for your actions, and that is something that we wish to avoid at all costs. Saying sorry implies that you've done something wrong and may lead to some sort of punishment, so be slippery. Make a non-apology apology. What's that, you say? Well, it's a statement that has the form of an apology but does not express the expected contrition. It allows the speakers to say that they are not specifically sorry for their behaviour, statement or action, but rather sorry because the aggrieved party is seeking apology or threatening retaliation. The non-apology apology is your classic career-saving technique. A simple example would be to say, well, I'm sorry if you feel that way. This apology does not admit that there's anything wrong with the original statement and also insinuates that the offended party is rather thin-skinned and a little too easily upset. Another example is the if apology, and this one is very good. I apologise if I offended anybody. Again, this implies that that you didn't actually do anything wrong, and also that you were getting to the heart of their complaint while simultaneously brushing them off completely. This one is particularly useful on lefty, liberal, commie, pinko, sissies and the like. Oh, I'm sorry if my words offended any of you. You could say mistakes were made. This is another example of avoiding blame. The speaker acknowledges that a situation was handled poorly or in an inappropriate manner, but seeks to evade any direct admission or accusation by specifying what or who made the mistakes. Mistakes does not imply malicious intent, but rather an unfortunate outcome. And if you are skillful, you can make people believe this rubbish. But these types of problems can be avoided in the first place by simply avoiding the question. There are a number of evasion tactics that you can use. First, just ignore the question. Pretend you didn't hear it and just blather on with a prepared statement. You could dismiss the question. You could say, that's not the question. The real question should be this. And then blather on with a prepared statement. If this does not work, you can acknowledge the question but still not actually answer it. You could question the question. You could request clarity on one or more points. The more the better. Or simply on what is meant by simple words or phrases. You could reflect the question. You could say, well, tell me what you think. Now, this might backfire if the person asking the question actually knows what they're talking about. But you could attack the question by pointing out a number of flaws. You could say, whether it's true or not, the question fails to address the important issue. It's far too speculative. It's based on false premise. It's factually inaccurate. It includes a misquote. It includes quotes that have been taken out of context. Or you could just simply say, well, that question is objectionable. If this does not work, or is not likely to work, I personally would attack the questioner themselves. Question their motivation, or make some ad hominem attack on their character or associations. Perhaps say that they worked for some large corporation. The final stage is to decline to give an answer on some grounds or other. You could say that you are unable to give an answer, perhaps saying that you don't have all the facts or cannot make a judgment on the limited information that you've been given. You could plead complete ignorance of the situation. You could say that you're unwilling to answer, perhaps saying that it would be irresponsible to cast judgment at this time. Simply defer them by saying, I'm sorry, I can't give you an answer to the question at this particular juncture. You could also say, well, I can't speak for somebody else, which is brilliant because it also shifts the blame to someone else. Place the responsibility on someone else. Say, to be honest, this is really a question for John and not me. You see, this implies that John is ultimately to blame, but of course, we didn't say that, did we? Well, that draws us to the end of today's presentation, and if you've taken anything away from it, I hope that you've taken this one lesson. Sales is war. Sales is a war on common sense. So I want you to all take that lesson and go out there and unleash sell. Thank you. Thank you. Right, I'm not usually horrible like that, but so if anyone's got any questions, please go ahead. Hiya.
Yeah, I seem to remember a few years ago you were talking about political questions and that. When Tony Blair was Prime Minister, there was some sort of question time type environment where he was the only guest.
Okay.
Somebody, I think it was, he was talking about a referendum on the EU exit, and somebody asked him specifically, what will the question be in the referendum? He said, I'll tell you what the question will be, then completely change the subject mid-sentence.
Yeah, it's a very common tactic. I mean, there's actually a really good episode of Yes Minister that deals with that sort of thing, where she's been interviewed by Ludo, I forget his name, the guy with the glasses. But yeah, it's a very common tactic. I mean, all of those are sort of, you know, trained to politicians as ways of dealing with the press, basically. So, you know, next time you see some politicians being harangued or whatever, see how many of these that they actually use.
And it's, why do politicians always tell you to
look? That particular thing is just to say, like, you stop talking, and it's to give them a fraction of a second and redirect the thing. It's putting yourself in charge and directing the conversation, basically. But they're very slippery guys.
They're all trained.
Oh, yeah, of course, yeah. It's public relations, which, as we now know, is essentially propaganda. So, you know, if you take away the fancy word, politicians are essentially trained in propaganda to deal with members of the press and the public so that they deflect questions, basically. Because, to be honest, a lot of the time, politicians don't really have an awful lot of power, but they need to give that impression of power. So, there's a lot of nonsense, basically. Hello?
You mentioned a number of people at the top that are at the forefront of the media.
Mm.
You mentioned John Lennon, Elvis Presley came up a few times, this, that, and the other. You mentioned people who lost their daughter.
Oh, yeah.
Am I to understand that anybody who reaches the top of their field becomes somehow contaminated?
No. I mean, that may be the case, but that wasn't really the point that I was trying to make. It was the point I was trying to make was, well, particularly about the McCanns, was the unusual way that they evoked public relations lawyers rather than rather than going into any sort of investigation, which seems anathema to most people who would deal with that sort of, you know, you've lost a child, why would you be dealing with your public image rather than dealing with the actual case. And with John Lennon, it was just a sort of joke about misunderstanding the purpose of his dream. But with Elvis Presley, there were rumours that Elvis Presley had a boyfriend. Now, obviously, he had children and stuff like that, and I'm not suggesting that's so terrible. But it's just curious that some people have a very prescribed public image, and their private image is quite different, and that just seemed like an obvious way of utilising that example. It's not criticism of anyone for being homosexual at all. It's just saying that it's the mirror opposite of what the public expected. And it was more really just, he was just one in a long line of examples like Montgomery Clift and Rock Hudson and people like that, basically. So, but regarding the top, I don't really know. Hiya.
All these politicians, throughout the West, are all using the same techniques.
Yeah.
Who's doing the training?
Oh, well, I mean, often. I mean, Tavistock actually does then training for politicians. There'll be lots of public relations agencies almost like stagecraft and media outlets. Press officers will do a lot of it. and such like that, people like Alistair Campbell and that. It very much depends on the where in their career the politician is, who they're surrounded by and stuff like that. But it's such an integral part of politics nowadays, public image, that I would imagine each party has like consultants, you know, on sort of on permanent pay that are training people to actually deal with these situations before they occur. So who it is specifically, I don't know. I know that Tavistock do that, and they also do it for blue chip companies as well, so that, you know, CEOs can be more effective. CEOs, essentially, they can, you know, be more powerful, be more powerful and dictative over their workforce, for example. So, so who knows? But there are people that do it. Anyone? Don't be shy. Hey.
Have you? You know, you mentioned Edward Bernays.
Yeah. He's his nephew. Is it his nephew twice? Once by marriage and once by blood. So was it something like his sister, his auntie married Freud's sister, brother or something? Edward Bernays, he's related to Freud, but he's related to him twice, isn't he? Once by marriage and once by blood, basically. But yes, he's... Yeah, absolutely. Him and Ivy Lee were responsible for utilising the concept of the press release as a sort of soft Trojan horse of advertising, basically. You know, you get a newspaper article. I mean, that's another thing. You go in any newspaper and look on the front page of the website or whatever, there'll be, it's usually here, there's the main story, and it's there. There'll be a story that, if you look at it, it's just advertising a product. It's done in a way, sometimes it's like, miracle trial shows this wonder drug does X, Y, and Z. If you actually look at it, these are from publicity firms, basically. That's another thing. A lot of people always say, why are the Kardashians always in the paper? I don't want to read about the Kardashians, blah, 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 blah. Well, you know why the Kardashians are in the paper? Because they pay to be put in the papers. There's essentially three... Well, it used to be the concept of, like, you know, roving journalists going out there and getting stories. You can't do that anymore. So you get your stories either off newswires like AP or Reuters or something like that. So that's reliant on the Reuters journalist getting it right. Because if it's wrong, it just gets repeated over and over again, verbatim, and passed throughout the world. That's why when you see all these people in the news media saying exactly the same thing, script by script by script, and they say the news media is scripted, yes, to an extent it is. Often that's because what we have a thing called churnalism now rather than journalism, where they simply don't have time to fact check. They assume that whatever's come from the news wire is accurate and just repeat it verbatim. And the other main source of news nowadays is from public relations firms, because you've got 24-hour rolling news, you've got an incredible amount of space that you need to fill, and it's mutually beneficial. So the Kardashians will pay for 20 stories to go to 1,000 different outlets every week, or every day probably, or something like that, which is why you get this media saturation, basically. But yeah, he was the father of public relations, certainly. Anyone else? Yeah, man.
You say it's more parties manipulating the media in terms of what we hear about the politics, or would you say they're too complicit?
I think they're very complicit, and I think the Sun example shows that. I think there's sometimes an uneasy sort of balance. Sometimes it's mutually beneficial to work together, like in the Sun campaign. It was great for the Sun. It was great, ultimately, for the government. It made the government look silly, but then it made them look magnanimous in defeat, if you know what I mean. And then so it softened their image off to the public. And that happens an incredible amount. I mean, I'll put it this way, right, okay. Whenever you see a royal being papped, or it's been set up, usually when you see, like, there was a great one, actually, just like, I know this isn't politics, but it's an example. There was an example of, like, Justin Bieber wandering around sucking a dummy at some music festival, and this came out last week, and next to nobody understood what the point of that was. Justin Bieber's put that post, that picture out there, because sucking a dummy indicates that he's at this festival and he's on MDMA or ecstasy. That's what you do when you're on MDMA. Now he's giving that subtle message and letting his fans who are growing up know that he's dangerous. He takes MDMA, he's cool, but he didn't say that, did he? No, he didn't, but he did, because he advertised it. So that would be how, say, politicians would work as well. They'll get stories out there like that. So I think it varies, but there is an incredible collusion. More so than you would expect. Far more than you'd expect. Anyone? Yes?
Is there anything positive actually being put out for us to come in?
Not by me.
I mean, things like environmental issues.
Regarding but well, I mean, I'm sure there are some people there. Hopefully, regarding my talk, although it seems quite negative, hopefully the idea is that basically it's giving you some sort of tricks. Do you know what I mean? That's kind of the point of this. It's a bit of a satire and stuff like that. I'm supposed to be, like, now when you watch a politician and he says, that's not the question, blah, 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 you'll be able to go, like, oh, yeah, that's one of those techniques. And so hopefully, it's like anything. It's like a magic trick. Once you know the technique, once you go, right, okay, that's not really your nose, that's my thumb, it loses all its sort of power, doesn't it? So in a similar way, I think that's the positive that you can take out.
Yeah. What are your thoughts on the alternative media?
I'm going to pick my words very carefully here. I think, like any institution, it's open to fevered egos and people that like to push stuff, perhaps to gain more traction than to actually serve a public duty. So, of course, there's some very good stuff in there, but there's some very good stuff on the BBC. I know it's very fashionable to hate on the BBC, but we will miss it when it goes. The BBC has been in decline ever since they exposed the government and the 45 dossier that led to the murder of David Kelly. The BBC, although it's full of lies and manipulation and rubbish, has basically been fighting against the government since that time. And we're going to miss it when it's gone, because the BBC is one of the only outlets that actually is so vast that, yes, there's a lot of crap in there. Yes, an incredible amount of propaganda in there. But there is a few outlets where, essentially, they get good, challenging documentaries and news media and stuff that actually is very, very good and vital for the general public, in a way that you don't get on Sky News, and you don't get on ITV, and you don't get on CNN or Fox, certainly. So, yeah, it's a bit of a strange one.
Great hand for Neil Sanders, please.